So I'm sure you could you all hear what I said before, or don't you? Yeah, okay. This is more for the other purposes, is it? Okay. So like I said, today I'm going to just present a bit of the background to the field, leading into some projects that I've been involved with. If there's any terms that I use or any terminologies that you're not clear about or confused, just feel free to put your hand up or shout out. It'd be worthwhile addressing those as we go, I think. So technology to support autistic populations is the work I've been involved with. We're going to look at what technologies and why, specifically for people with autism. Like I said, some examples of previous work, historical contextual work that's gone on in this area, as well as some work that I've been doing. I'm then going to approach some of the questions that the field still isn't addressing or isn't answering or isn't really thinking about at the moment, and hopefully establishing where some of the gaps in knowledge still are, I think. So first, just to sort of briefly summarise what autism is, perhaps there's a few of you here who are not necessarily aware, but autism is a spectrum condition which affects three key areas. It's a developmental condition, so it's a neurological condition, and it affects fundamentally social skills, social communication, and repetitive behaviours, and in some cases, obsessions. So compulsive, stereotyped, sameness, and self-injury are the three areas that somebody with autism, diagnosed with autism, would present with. It is a spectrum condition within those sort of three areas, so it can range from very low functioning people with very low IQs and multiple disabilities, with no language in some cases, right the way through to very gifted individuals with very high levels of IQ who are able to present with very sort of specific interests. Mathematicians, for example, are one area where people sort of border that sort of Asperger's, high-functioning autism. So they're very gifted in some cases. The prevalence has increased since it was first described in the 1940s, as you would imagine, as we're more able to diagnose these things and we become more aware of them. So it can affect up to 1 in 54 people in some parts of the world. The actual average now is 1 in 68. So 1 in 68 people would present with an autism spectrum condition, which, depending on your perspective, is quite a few people, really. So there is a drive to think about how we can support these populations as they are becoming more prevalent. And one of the arguments is technology can be quite an affordable way of supporting this group. And finally, as it says there, about 50% of people with autism fail to develop any useful natural language, which can obviously be a problem in terms of their ability to communicate things they need and so on. So from a research perspective in the area of technologies and autism, there's been quite a bit reported using virtual environments, virtual worlds, social media, wearable technologies, virtual reality and head-mounted displays more recently, I think, multimedia programs, and of course iPads through the use of apps as well has been identified as key areas that can support this group. And they've all been used, in studies as a way to initiate interactions. So people with autism would struggle with initiating a conversation with somebody, so they've been used as a way to help support that particular challenge. Essentially, technologies can slow down the communication process. And for somebody who has a neurological condition and could become quite worried about cognitive overload, cognitive pressures, it can be quite important that communication is slowed down. And people, we tend not to do that, but computers can be one way that we can sort of make that happen. It removes the need for face-to-face communication as well. It's been well documented that people with autism can, in some cases, struggle with recognizing facial emotions and understanding when maybe somebody's angry, for example, with them. So it's been used as a way to mediate that face-to-face communication. And in some ways, it's been used, as it says here, to help people with autism identify facial recognitions. An area that I'm going to talk about in a bit more detail is support and test social situations. So again, the ability for somebody with autism to make friends, to develop social interest in social, or navigate social situations and understand that the right thing to do when you go in a coffee shop is to join the back of a queue and wait to be served as opposed to jumping into the front of the queue. So it's those sort of social awareness opportunities that technologies can help support this group with. There are others there as well. Quite importantly, actually, as we mentioned earlier, that 50% of people with autism can fail to develop useful language, it's important that actually it can provide a voice in many cases for people with autism to communicate their needs. And as you can imagine, an iPad is a really good way of doing that, using sort of touchscreen interfaces, very simple interfaces, to help someone with autism say that they're scared or they're angry or they're anxious, and they can communicate those sort of things using technologies. Thank you for the drink. So, one of the reasons computers and technologies more broadly have been used for this population has been because, and I think autism was once seen as a sort of a deficit-based model. In other words, people with autism were described as having a deficit or having an issue with something. But more and more we're talking about the strengths that people with autism can offer society now, more so. So there are companies set up, for example, technologies companies who understand that people with autism can be very bright with things like programming, mathematics. They can debug software very, very quickly because they can understand patterns. So people are tapping into that potential more now. But computers and technologies are used with this group because they can play to the strengths of these of their condition, essentially. They can be predictable. So again, it removes that sort of social nuance. They're very predictable. They're not always socially complex. They can be less worrying than dealing with a person, often dealing with technology in some cases. As we found out maybe earlier with the audio, maybe not so, but often computers can provide that sort of safe space. They can provide a safe space for them to test and make mistakes as well, if used in the right context, which is really important. And they often involve a one-to-one interaction, a one-on-one interaction, as opposed to a one-to-many, which in society we're often faced with. And I think as people develop in that technology, they provide us the opportunity to tailor and control the sort of interventions or the sort of skills that we want to develop in this group. So for example, in some of the work we've been doing, we can increase the complexity of the virtual environments that we're using. So we can add more people as the person with autism becomes more confident in that space with maybe a couple of people. And so therefore they're more able to deal with. One example have been on a train, for example. So there's been environments created where you get on a train in the virtual environment, there's one or two people, and as you get more confident, the number of people that you include on the train can be increased, for example. So you're slowly staged up to what it would be like to be surrounded by lots of people. Now, we'll come to the question of generalization in a minute, or later on, because that is a big question mark in the field still, in terms of how things generalize from sort of technological sort of control and interventions to the real world. And I think the press have, I'm not sure what the press is like in Latvia, but in the UK, the press can often get hold of sort of good news stories and really overplay them and make them sound a bit more attractive than they are. But there has been a lot of interest in press around the use of technologies to support these groups. For example, here you can see scaling the heights to go and shop in a virtual reality room is now helping people with autism overcome phobias. And again, it oversimplifies the actual nuance of the work going on underneath this often. Another one is job training as well, which is something we're developing also. So the opportunity to go into a virtual sort of job interview situation and test out the way that you might deal with that. Working with young adults within a virtual world, which is some of the work I've been involved with, which I'll get to. Virtual world teaches real world skills. Maximizing the effectiveness of the iPad for people with autism. So there's been a lot of work talked, couched around that. But only a small amount of research and data often back up some of these claims. So again, it says here, people with autism working with iPads because they're predictable and neat. And there has been work done probably about 10, 15 years ago now about the idea that technologies for people with disabilities, there's no reason they shouldn't be neat and they shouldn't be similar to what everyone else uses. Often they're so bespoke and made in such a way that they're not even, nobody would want to use them. But now with things like, you know, iPads and other devices as that, we're finding that people with autism are drawn to them as they are predictable and neat. Minecraft, which is a form of virtual world. Have you come across Minecraft? Is that familiar? Yeah, so that's something else that people with autism have created communities within. And they have actually created communities in there, so they can go in and they can ask each other about the sort of challenges they're experiencing and how best they might navigate those within, from a peer group, which is quite important, I think. So that's another interface. And then much more recently, virtual reality head-mounted displays have been identified as something that can potentially help people with autism. But the problem here, and this is where one of the studies I'll come on to in a bit. One of the problems here, it's a wearable technology, as you can see. And people with autism have sensory problems, so they might not like being touched and so on. So people were suggesting that VR could answer a lot of questions around autism and provide a lot of affordances, but they haven't asked some of the basic scientific questions around wearability, acceptability, presence, immersion, and negative effects, which also virtual reality head-mounted displays can sometimes... Have anyone used a head-mounted display, I wonder? Here? No. So if you had worn one, you would probably experience some sickness, and there was some sort of negative press around the sort of nauseousness that was experienced in these spaces. So with all of that going on, nobody had actually asked some of the basic questions to the autistic community, saying, is this something that would benefit you? Is this something you would be willing to wear and use? So that's some of the work that we did that I'll come on to later. So, in summary, I guess, there has been a lot of promise and some positive research reported, and the press has picked up on some of the good stories, I guess. But the question still remains around what the data actually tells us, what the scientific information is on what the actual impact of these technologies are, and where they can be best applied, which is a really big question. So within autism-based research, you can see here quite clearly, and I appreciate it's a wee bit dated, but you can see here quite clearly that the focus of autism research has been, from 1998 to 2009, very much focused on the social emotional behavior as opposed to anywhere else. So again, we're moving away from this model of let's try and fix autism, because that isn't something that's ever gonna happen, but rather thinking how we can support people with autism with their social emotional behavioral challenges and education, so they can live long lives, long lives, as opposed to this sort of medical model of trying to medicate or fix. So that's why that is probably a lot lower there. If that was 10 years earlier, I bet that might have been slightly the other way around. And within that research endeavor, you can see here that communication and interaction is a huge part of that specifically. So really thinking about communication and interaction opportunities for people with autism has been a feature of the field within that time period there, 2004 to 14. So I'm going to move on briefly now to what some of the sort of projects that have been done previously are and what they look like and what some of the findings tended to indicate. So this is one of the very first virtual reality head-mounted display projects that was devised in the world for people with autism over in California, Dorothy Strickland and colleagues. As you can see, 1996. Seems like quite a long time ago, maybe to me, maybe more than many of you, but it isn't that long ago in the terms of building up an evidence base, in terms of the science, I guess, here. This is still quite early-based research. So in 96, Strickland and colleagues looked at just the sort of questions that I've been looking at recently, which are, would someone with autism wear a head-mounted display? And if they would wear it, would they be able to interpret what was happening in those spaces? And she, in particular, looked at crossing a road safely using that environment. So again, people with autism can't often spy dangers very well. And running out in front of traffic would be something someone with autism might do. So she wanted to ask some questions around that. Now, you can see the headset's rather huge. I mean, it is really rather big, clumsy. It's wired to big computers behind there that are running the software. So it was a lab-based experiment. So this wasn't done in a classroom or in somewhere in the home, for example, but rather it was done in a lab. So people were brought into the lab and they were run through this experiment. But she found that people with autism were willing to accept the technology, wear the technology, and use the technology to a successful outcome of learning to cross a road safely in that case. You'll notice also the quality of the graphics that are being displayed to the participants there. And as we move on a few years, the graphics don't improve that much, and we've moved on probably depends on where you look at those studies, but it's almost, you know, nine years. And the graphics are still very simple. And this is because a lot of these projects have to involve a bespoke set of design procedures and software design procedures, because there's nothing off the shelf very easily available. So projects are often time limited, so they need to develop things as quick as they can, so they often opt for, you know, graphics that are very basic. So the work of Sarah Parsons and Peter Mitchell in the early 2000s, started to use virtual environments, which are akin to a simulation, a game, if you like. Something that you run, you work through a bunch of things that happen, and then the game ends, or the simulation ends. Here, they were interested in looking at social conventions and how people with autism might or might not adhere to social conventions. So I guess, you know, they become less stigmatized when they're not adhering to social conventions. So here they looked at getting on a bus and sitting on a bus in an appropriate place. They also looked at a coffee shop and going into a coffee shop and ordering a coffee in an appropriate, socially appropriate manner, in a conventional manner. And they did this in classroom with children, and they went back to the children sort of weeks and months afterwards to see how their learning may have generalized from those spaces into the real world. And again, they started to find some interesting results that indicated that, yes, indeed, the simulations were providing some sense that they could transition from those environments and some of those behaviors into the real world. So that was a sort of the first sort of, yeah, some of the first findings that started to indicate that these technologies could generalize across, but I'll come back to that later. Other colleagues, Mark Fabry and David Moore. Again, these are both of these last two studies were UK-based. And here they looked at using emojis, I guess, or using facial recognition techniques. They looked at, could technologies, by removing some of the complexities of our human faces and transporting emotions onto a digital avatar, was that any better for people with autism recognizing emotions? And surprisingly, they identified that, yes, indeed, that was the case. But what they also wanted to do here was look at how, again, that translated across. So they were interested in how they could augment sort of typing a message with using facial expressions, and could they sort of attribute the appropriate meaning to the things that they wanted to communicate. And again, they found positive results that indicated, yes, that could indeed take place. More recently, 2013, colleagues in Texas, I think, identified that virtual worlds could be used as a way for social cognition training or a therapy session to take place online. So somebody with autism on the right here would log in to the internet and they could access a therapy session in Second Life. And as opposed to having to go into a real life situation and do that, they could experience it online again, therefore drawing upon all the affordances of working in a technological computer-based environment. In other words, reduce cognitive pressures, removal of face-to-face communication, but they could communicate as effectively in these spaces. So that was another study that again identified some really positive outcomes. This is work in Newcastle, which is a northern part of the UK. Maskey and colleagues here have looked at reduced anxiety and fear of phobias. I think we saw the headline earlier from a newspaper article. And here, people with autism, as you can see, were sat down in front of a fully immersive set of screens that are on top of them, around the front and the side and the back of them. They'd sit in this space, and they'd be presented with a bunch of situations which would help them overcome phobias, essentially. I think spiders was one of the ones that they looked at. And they again found through their work that yes, the people they worked with were able to overcome their fears of spiders. I think one of the examples was flying was another. And they did a follow-up study 6 months and 12 months later, which showed that that learning had not just generalized, but it had generalized over a sustained period of time, which was one of the first studies to kind of ask that question. Does this thing generalize, and for how long does it generalize? We've already talked about sort of job interview training, but yeah, there's been some multimedia, kind of an old word, multimedia, not sure if we use it anymore, but digital media solutions and representations of a job interview here where you might type in your responses to what's happening in this environment. I think that's more general, that's a general probably learning opportunity as opposed to just for autistic groups, but in this context, they work with autistic participants. And they found compared to their typically developing peers, that they were able to overcome some of the challenges of a job interview. So I think sort of in sum and through this work, the type of messages we take away really are that people with, and especially children on the autism spectrum, are able to use a range of virtual environments, collaborative virtual environments, virtual reality, and in the case we saw very big, cumbersome lab-based technologies. They're able to use them and accept them. They're able as it says here, to accept them as a form of reality as well, which is important in terms of the generalization. Better place in virtual reality environments to focus attention, gain confidence, and successfully navigate parallel tasks. So that's been shown to be the case through the data of these studies. And they're able to become immersed on par with their typically developing peers, which in a way kind of starts to level the playing field, if you like. So in other words, if you go into a virtual world and you've got autism, you're in a wheelchair, you've got whatever going on, when you're in that space, nobody needs or necessarily knows that, and it becomes a level playing field. And I think, you know, on that basis, they're able to, in part, become, you know, start interacting on par with their peers. And as the work we looked at, Sarah Parsons and colleagues, they're able to communicate and adhere to some social conventions in those spaces. So some of the challenges that have faced this field, really, have been that the graphics have not been great in all cases. And I think as researchers, we speculate that the graphics could or should be as customizable and realistic as possible. Only some skills are or have been generalizable. And I think that's a bigger challenge, or bigger question in the field at the moment. The design of these environments haven't often involved autistic users, so they've been designed for them as opposed to with them, which is bad practice in many sort of design contexts. Integration into spaces, I'll put school teaching here as an example, but integration into somewhere where people with these disabilities can best access the technologies is really important. It's pointless doing this work in labs with people if they can't then benefit, you know, when the study's finished, when we've got the data that we want and we've answered some questions, but you know, no one actually stands to benefit in the long term. So I think integration into school-based settings is one substantial opportunity if these technologies are to be beneficial for these groups. We can then start aligning the work we're doing with curriculum and so on, which I think can only benefit. Are there any questions, I wonder, at the moment, or any points of observation I can open up at this point before I move on to a couple of case studies? Nothing? Nothing for clarification? Am I talking too quickly or too loudly or not loudly enough? Sorry? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so you're right. So that's a good question. So the question was around the negative implications of using technology. And no, they haven't been addressed to answer that sort of bluntly. And issues around, they obviously have obsessive compulsive sort of leanings, I guess. So yeah, you're right, someone with autism could end up latching onto, you know, a virtual world and want to be there all the time. And that's where I think situating it and embedding it into things like classrooms or into maybe centers that, in which they're working, is one place we can control that. And it is about how we control that access. There can be other measures put in place, of course, but that's a very difficult question. I mean, that's a question broadly, isn't it, I think, about how we sort of limit access to technologies, overuse of technologies. And is that even a bad thing if they become obsessed and they want to be in that space maybe for, you know, for a fair amount of time? That's another question that we don't know the answer to, but it's a fair question. There are a lot of ethical dilemmas around this area which haven't been approached at all adequately yet. So the first project I'm going to look at is a virtual world that we looked at designing with a view to support social communication in a classroom-based setting. And here we wanted to look at using text-based communication, so computer-mediated communication, as it's otherwise known, again, had been shown to sort of reduce cognitive pressures for people with autism. So we wanted to use text-based communication. We wanted to explore facial expression recognition and use of facial expression recognition. We also wanted to look at, avatar design and how people with autism design their avatars, because that says a lot about how immersed you become in a virtual world, or so research tells us. I wanted to replicate some real-world environments in this space, and I wanted to design it in conjunction with the school teachers and the children, so the spaces were something that they would like to explore. I also looked... something that hasn't been done very well in the field to date was looking at what was going on in those spaces from their perspective. So that's how I went into and approached this particular study. I wanted to understand how they experienced the space. It was embedded into a classroom context, so it was embedded into a classroom. It was embedded into the ICT, Information Communication Technology class. So the issues around, as you mentioned earlier, around the concerns of overusing the technology. In a virtual world, if it's not a locked down space, anybody can join from around the world. So we created a private island, and we made sure they only accessed this, you know, this during their class, you know, for 1 hour once a week it was, I think. So we tried to address some of that and to contain some of those issues. So this is what it looked like. There were quite a few challenges to overcome. I don't know how many of you may have worked with technology in schools, and I'm not sure what schools are, of course, like in Latvia, but in the UK, they're very tightly monitored. The government has a lot of control over how technology is and can be used. I'll come on to some of that shortly. So there was a variety of different challenges, but this was what the project looked like in its reality, I guess. You can see students were sat around the room on different laptops using accessing the virtual world. They had worksheets, as you can see on the top there, so they were guided. They had some scaffold as to what they should do in those spaces, so they weren't just running around aimlessly, I guess. And they were asked to customize their avatars. That's something I'm not going to dwell upon too much in terms of how they represented themselves, but that's something I might come back to towards the end, actually. So this is the island that we designed in conjunction with the user group. They wanted sort of a fun fair and group activity zone or areas, a zoo they wanted as something they could go with, a space they could go with and visit with their friends. And they also wanted quiet areas. Often schools for people with autism have quiet rooms, a room they can go if they're getting sort of overwhelmed, becoming anxious. So we felt it was, or they felt, and I felt that it was appropriate to have that sort of space available in the virtual world. It kind of made sense to me, so we built that. So this is what it actually looks like. Again, the graphics have moved on, I guess, from the work we looked at earlier. So they're kind of realistic. They're moving towards that, you know, towards that. And we designed a variety of sort of social spaces that the users could go to a coffee shop, McDonald's, as you can see, train station. There's a train station there as well. So the sort of areas that they would encounter in their day-to-day lives we wanted to sort of bring into this space. And there's some more there. Fun fairs, basketball, arcades, bowling. There's a variety of different things that the users could access and do. And the quiet spaces here, as you can see, for them. So like I said, we wanted to explore how they communicated in those spaces and what sort of perceived benefits they got from that. So it was, we found that text chat was the only and preferred option of communication in the virtual world. So in other words, they weren't that interested using facial expressions or communicating via facial expressions on their avatars. Body gestures and things like that weren't experimented with or used either. So really, text chat was their main form of communication. They had a confidence and willingness to engage with the text chat quite quickly, some of them more slowly. But as time went on, some displayed initial problems with communication using text chat. But that grew as the confidence grew throughout the case study, which lasted 10 weeks. So by week two or three, we found that everybody was quite readily engaged with the text chat. So familiarity was quite an important thing in that case, I think. We set them a series of tasks that they would work on weekly to help them develop their social skills, working in those various spaces. And it became quite clear that in-world facilitation, so the teacher would normally work with them in the classroom. And again, we found through this, kind of by accident, that it was important the teacher was also with them in the virtual world. So having the ability for the teacher to facilitate the stuff in the virtual world was important. And that was something we didn't grasp onto until later in the study, actually. But that became really important. There were also times when prompts were still required to initiate conversation and so on. So there were still some of the challenges that the students had in the space, in the real world, that were sort of transported into that space. But as I said, as they became more familiar, that really did become less problematic. They reported feeling comfortable in the space and happy to widen their social group in world to other friends and possibly parents. So I think that starts to indicate and provide some leaning towards the type of opportunities that these spaces could perhaps provide. there have been cases where people with autism only communicate with their parents through their mobile phone and through text messages, for example, because that is their most, that's where they can communicate most effectively. So this is, again, something that sort of picked up on that. So I think, although they were communicating quite freely in the virtual world, that doesn't necessarily mean it's appropriate or it's of any value, I guess. So I wanted to look at the conversations they were having and code them into sort of being appropriate or not appropriate conversations that you would have. And as you can see here, we found it varied quite a bit across the group. But you can see there's quite a high level of appropriate communication among many, in some cases 100% for one of those participants, and fairly low in another. But nonetheless, the person that displayed quite low appropriate behaviors was somebody who didn't speak in class at all. They didn't talk in class at all, but they were talking with their peers and their teacher in the virtual world. And it's something they didn't do in the classroom at all. So despite some of it being not necessarily appropriate or coded as being appropriate, it was still nonetheless some communication they were having with their teacher for the first time, which was quite revealing, I think. So I think the in-context and the sort of in-situ frame that this particular study sort of sought to address is something that's really, really, really important. I think if you can work in situ, if you can take the technology into the classroom or into centres or into spaces where people with autism can access it, it provides a lot of positive things that you can do, I guess. Firstly, that you can control many of those parts, the ethical issue around how long they use the technology for, you can start to have some control of that. You can troubleshoot problems. So we did have a few times when the computers crashed or the software crashed, which is something we all experience and that does happen. And again, the students found that quite problematic when it happened. They weren't able to easily deal with that. So it was important that by doing it in situ and being with them, we were able to kind of deal with that appropriately as we needed to. I think there's more opportunities to design this type of technology with participants if you design it in situ, if you go into the spaces where these people are working. You're able to modify parts of the technology as you go. So there were some issues with the software when we first started working, but because we were there, we were able to deal with those quite quickly. And of course, you're able to quite easily provide information and feedback to teachers and parents in this case. So it was useful for us to feed back to the teachers what we were finding, and the parents and the students themselves. And that only happens, I think, when you are more embedded into the situation. So yeah, I mentioned earlier about the technological issues, notwithstanding the software issues and so on. Again, in the UK, as I said, the local governments control a lot of what schools can access on the internet. And the virtual world we used was an internet-based piece of software. So we needed to access through the school's firewall. Does that make sense if I say it? Yeah. So that was something we had to carefully negotiate. We had to apply for permission to do that. We had to negotiate it. It took time. If they weren't willing to do that, this project wouldn't have happened at all. So that is a real barrier, I think, to using technologies, certainly in schools, in my experience in the UK anyway. Is that something that would be the case here, I wonder? Is there any of you have any experience of that you don't know? No. Okay. So it might be, but it's a contextual consideration. And again, I'll come on to a few of those in a second. So in some ways, the technology can be, although it's more controllable in many ways, it can be therefore become less controllable if you encounter issues like that. In many public areas, there's limited access to the internet. So things like the gatekeepers, as we call them, the people who gave me access to the internet from this school, those gatekeepers become really important to understand how to negotiate that. So therefore, identifying the stakeholders was really important. And so what else came out of the work that I did was a sort of a framework, if you like, a flow diagram, a framework of how to best go about embedding and working with virtual worlds in schools for people with autism. And the particular point worth sort of drawing our attention to here is this, I think, which is the contextual considerations, thinking about what issues really matter before you can even start designing any. In this case, virtual worlds for people with autism. So the room and the layout was really important. We found that when we started the study, we had them in one room together. And of course, instead of communicating through the computers, they just started shouting across the room to each other. So having that space appropriately designed and spreading them across different rooms was important. The school equipment, was it able enough to manage the software we required it to, you know, to work with? And when we come on to the virtual reality stuff later, you know, quite serious machines and sort of graphics cards are required to run some of that graphical equipment. And so it becomes a challenge. Schools aren't often well funded in the UK. So issues around the types of technologies and can they run what we need them to run is a problem. Individual user needs. So quite quickly, I had to assess whether the people we were working with were able to input using keyboard controls and mouse controls, because that's an assumption we often make, isn't it, as sort of neurotypicals, that we can do that. Some people would struggle with that. The bandwidth and the ports. So by using the internet, was the bandwidth large enough? Could we download the content we needed? Would the software work, you know, fast enough? And the ports, of course, could we even access the internet to start with? So that all became really vital to accessing in any way what we needed to. So I don't know if the audio will play, I hope not. No, so this is just, so another way that we've been working with virtual worlds in the UK, we were successful in getting some money from the government, the Department of Work and Pensions, to be exact. And they're concerned with getting people back to work. So one of the challenges and barriers, a lot of people with autism are, often remain unemployed. About, I think about 38% of people with autism experience employment. So there's many that don't. So one thing that we identified was that virtual worlds could be a possible space where we could actually create a job center, which is where people in the UK go to get advice on how to get jobs, what type of jobs are available, which ones they should be applying for, support on writing CVs, writing applications, and so on. And these are often really depressing places to visit in the UK, and they can provide a lot of challenges for people with autism. And we've talked about what some of those are. You know, they're very busy places. You know, they can be very pressurized places, confusing places, places you need to demonstrate a lot of social awareness. So by being able to get all of that support through a virtual world, through the affordances of this space, was something that we wanted to look at. And we, like I say, we got some funded to do. And we found that everybody that we signed up to use this particular opportunity were able to successfully gain employment. So it became kind of like an opportunity of a way through and around the traditional way of getting a job in the UK or supporting people getting a job in the UK, to providing an opportunity that, again, spoke to some of the affordances of this using this type of technology. So this was one another example in which we've used a virtual world successfully. So interactive devices, I'm just put this slide up there briefly. I'm going to move on to the next project after this. But interactive devices have been used, as I talked about earlier, things like picture exchange communication systems. So for people with autism to, without verbal language, to be able to communicate their needs. And as you can imagine, carrying a very small device around with you and being able to communicate effectively is very appealing to, you know, to these groups. So some researchers in Edinburgh, in the UK, in Scotland, have looked at what type of off-the-shelf apps that are used on an iPhone, for example, here, which ones can be classified into communication, life skills, education, and fun, opportunities for people to learn. So they've started to identify that these apps that you see here can be potentially used into those, one of those four areas. But again, there is a real dearth, actually, in this area of evidence base. So there's not much evidence base yet that suggests any of these apps are any helpful, really. So that work is, I think, still ongoing. So I'm going to move. I think I've probably just got about another 20 minutes, if that's OK, at most. So the second project we did very recently, collaborated with colleagues at Michigan State University in the US. And I think we were talking earlier, this project, what I wanted to do was bring together people from a variety of different disciplines. Because one thing this field hasn't done well is really sort of get a multidisciplinary perspective or angle on what's on how we can develop these technologies. So here we brought together therapists, psychologists, neuroscientists, support workers, carers. We brought together a variety of digital media practitioners. We brought games designers. So we brought a variety of different people together to look at virtual reality head-mounted display technologies for this group. And that's something that I think the more we can do of, the better we can get those different angles and perspectives to really create great opportunities for people with autism in these environments. So we looked at a news article earlier that suggested that VR is the next big thing for people with autism, can really help support them, but nobody had asked any of those basic questions that we that I alluded to earlier. So here we wanted to look at whether people with autism would accept this form of technology, where in the technology for a period of time. We wanted to also look at, we also wanted to look at the immersion presence and ecological validity that people with autism experience in these spaces. And what that really means is a sense of feeling natural, a sense of feeling natural in a virtual environment. We also wanted to look at the any negative effects with using that technology, feeling sick and so on. So we designed a study where we were, so we designed a study where we would go into a center, a rehabilitation center, they call them in the US. We went into a center, we set up a room, and people were able to come and use the technology, sign up to use, spend a period of time with us using the technology. I think we signed up 30 people in total. So another limitation to this field is it often works with very small groups of participants, which doesn't really tell us that much, because we know you can't generalize from one or two people's response to something across the larger population. So we worked with 30 participants, which for this field is kind of large, believe it or not. And the technology, of course, has become much more portable since the days of Dorothy Strickland and the work in 96. So we were able to quite affordably as well, it's not that expensive. I think everything you see there might cost £1,300 at most. So we were able to buy a kit of stuff and take it to the space and test it with some participants. Lightweight, you know, I was able to fly from London to the US with all of that in my bag and just unpack it, and it all worked. Surprisingly, it all worked. And so, as I said, I'm going to describe just briefly in a second what the phases of the study were. But what we found quite quickly, as you can see here, that people did start not just reporting to us through the questionnaire that we used to capture the data, but they can actually see here a real sense of presence or ecological validity in this space. So in this coffee shop scene, when the participant looks down, they can see their arms and they can see a cup of coffee, and you can see the participant there is reaching for it in sort of in the real world. So it really did propel them into this space, which is entirely different to screen-based media, of course. Entirely different. You know, it's 360, we've used that word a lot today. It's 360 degrees, so you can turn your head, you can stand up, you can crouch down, and you'll get the appropriate response. So in this particular environment, the more that you looked at the person sat opposite you, the more that they looked at you. And the less you paid them attention, the less they paid you attention. So it was that sort of social communication thing again. So here's some more examples of the participants using the kit. I think what I'm trying to get across here is just how portable, how easy it was to use. And some of these participants, I'll put their demographic data up. So the demographics are here. So you'll see that some of the participants we worked with had a really, we worked with a full range of the spectrum. So we, as you can see here, we worked with an IQ as low as 45 and as high as 138, with the average being around somewhere around 90. So we worked with some really bright people. We worked with some people with very challenging difficulties. We worked with people with a variety of different conditions associated with their autism, epilepsy, ADHD, anxiety, depression, Down syndrome, Fragile X. There's a variety of different issues associated with some of them. We worked with a range of ages as well. So one of the limitations of this work is that we didn't really target a particular group. We wanted to work with a sort of a range, really, to understand the acceptability of this technology. So the age range of 17 to 53 were who we worked with across that. But they all had a diagnosis of, you know, ASD, Asperger's, or pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified. So they had a form of autism. So in order to test the acceptability of wanting or willingness to wear the technology, we asked the participants to come in and spend about 30, 40 minutes with us, where we first presented them in the headset a virtual cinema, watching a film, then a virtual cafe that you just saw, and then a virtual safari, so driving a Jeep around somewhere in South Africa, I think it was. And each of those, the first one lasted about 5-6 minutes, the second one about 10, and the final one about 15. So what we wanted to do was not throw them in the deep end, but rather slowly stage the level of immersion and experience, increase it, I guess. We weren't able to do it using the technology. It wasn't that customizable. These were all off-the-shelf pieces of software that we were working with. And what we did was, through that process, we looked at how many people completed that activity. In the second phase, we invited 11 participants back to experience two longer exposures to the virtual reality environments. The first was an Apollo 11 mission, flying into space. And the second was a Tuscan house, which is the one that comes with the software, hardware we were using. And those both together lasted about 35 minutes. So what we found was, as you can see here, phase one, willingness to wear the head-mounted displays for at least one experience. 100% of the participants did that, 29 of them. The second experience, they all saw that through, so 29 of them completed that. And the final experience, only 25 wanted to complete that. So four people decided they didn't want to complete the third environment. Maybe they were feeling, some reported feeling sick, feeling a bit dizzy, for example. Some just didn't want to. 79% of the participants were willing to return for phase two of the study. We invited 11 back. And as you might expect, if they're coming back, that they all completed those experiences. So we found kind of a high level of acceptance, I think, and considering the range as well. Now, we found the willingness to complete all of those experiences was not associated with the IQ level. So there's no correlation between that, which was, again, an interesting finding. Because so often, work with technology and autistic groups tends to be with the higher functioning groups. So I think what we started to do here was identify that actually the lower functioning groups can also benefit from this technology if it's used appropriately. So quite handy, there happens to be a questionnaire that measures the sort of other things that we were looking at, which was the spatial presence. So you can see here, highlighted in bold, that's our study. So I'll look at that data first. So you can see here the presence was reported as 3.8 average, with 5 being the highest and 1 being the lowest. Engagement in the spaces was reported as being 4.1 on average. Ecological validity, 4. And negative effects, 2. So bearing in mind, 1 would be the lowest in terms of strongly disagreeing that they felt sick. So again, they reported not too much discomfort. But when we compare this to another study that looked at using the blue room. So if you remember, I described that study where people sat in front of the screens that surrounded them. So in that immersive virtual environment, they reported these data using the same questionnaire. And you can see, therefore, that people in our study reported feeling less negative effects using the head-mounted displays than using screen-based media, and even less than the typically developing group that particular study used. And interestingly, they reported, again, higher levels of ecological validity and engagement. So in other words, this head-mounted display potentially has less negative effects using screen-based media and much higher levels of immersion and presence, which can potentially address some of the issues around generalization, I would hypothesize, I would argue. Another thing we measured or looked at was being, again, conscious that people with autism can experience high levels of anxiety. We didn't want them to feel any more anxious, I think, in these spaces. So we did a pre and post measure of their state trait. It's called the state trait inventory. And we did that in the phase two of the study. So it was only with, again, a small group of people, 11. But what we found here was pre and post, you can see here, before they went in to do the second phase, they reported an average state of 35.1, and then after they'd done it, 30. So in other words, their state or their trait anxieties hadn't increased as a result of using it. And in fact, they'd decreased very slightly. So there was no evidence to suggest they feel any more anxious using a head-mounted display. But couched in the context that it was a very small group, you know, of participants. So really, the results, sort of in sum, suggested that there was a willingness to wear the equipment, the head-mounted display equipment, The input, they were able to use the inputs. They had an Xbox controller to navigate some of the scenes. And then in order to navigate the scenes, they used bodily interactions at various points. I think there was one here quite nicely. A guy stood up when he could look outside the top of the Jeep when he was driving around Africa. So he did that. And we saw the other one with the same participant actually trying to grab the coffee cup. And that wasn't unusual. You can see the participant on the left as well, looking around behind him in the cafe, for example. So this guy was not interested in looking at the lady sat opposite him, but rather looking around the room and looking for other things. So I think that sort of ecological validity argument really sort of stacks up when we start to see some of this stuff. So that, if it's of any interest, that work that I've just described is published in the Journal of Autism and Developmental Disorders. So yeah, I think, just coming back to these points, there was a self-reported high level of presence, immersion, and feeling natural in the space, lower levels of negative effects as compared to screen-based media in other studies, and anxiety was not increased as a result of using the technology. So we start to, I think, present through this study that these are potentially usefully acceptable spaces for these groups to use. What we didn't do, of course, we didn't target any interventions, we didn't design any bespoke software, we didn't scale up the amount of stimulus in the environments, add more that we would have liked to have done. So there's a lot more work to be done, I think, as we move forward. But we wanted to address some of those really basic assumptions that people were making about these technologies for these particular user groups. So I think the findings are interesting because the ecologically valid space for people with autism to test social situations and scenarios, this could be a really useful space for that. They provide potentially a flexible and immersive space to do this. As I said, flexibility in the context as programmers and designers, we can increase or reduce the levels of stimulus in these spaces. And not only social skills, but we can start to explore issues around anxiety and overwhelming contexts, as these can be appropriately adjusted through the use of the appropriate design of the software. So I think there is much promise with future research needed. The evidence base, as I said, is still at a very early stage. We've got some really interesting positive findings, but there's loads more work, research needed to be done to build that evidence base more substantially. There have been some really interesting results with some very positive outcomes from the studies I've highlighted, I think, and ours being sort of one of the latest in that area. There is an ability to use technologies as a tool for training and or support, but I think there is also a big area around creativity and about creative expression in these spaces for these groups. It shouldn't be overlooked, I don't think. There is a real need for creating very bespoke and very specific targeted interventions and build an evidence base about the potential outcome and the transferability of that into the real world. And I think there's a real pertinent point around engaging users from the ground up. What would they like to see in these spaces? What would be advantageous to them? And I think there's, a gap in our knowledge, or a gap, frankly, in our as researchers in terms of actually doing that. So there's a greater need for evidence-based targeted interventions, the role of creative play. The in-context and in-situ argument is still really important because, again, there's no point if we just give this technology and then take it away, but we need to leave it behind. We need to say, here it is, use it. And that can be best done, I think, sort of in contextually appropriate situations. So the center, the rehabilitation center we work with, there's no reason we couldn't leave that technology there and have people use it as and when they need to. Same with the school work or the work I did in a school. There's no reason it can't be left there for them to use after the researchers have left. So there have been limited involvement in autistic communities in this research, which I think is a real issue. Lack of personalization and lack of generalization hasn't been fully addressed in these spaces. The work has tended to focus on higher functioning groups of the autism spectrum, and I think there's a real need to address the full range. Very small numbers have been sort of worked with, I guess, at the moment. So we work with very small participants, small groups of participants, and again, trying to make statements or arguments that this one size fits all or this intervention fits this whole population is going to be much more difficult unless we start to target more longitudinal studies with larger groups. Long-term follow-up is also very limited in this area, so we haven't, in many of our studies, gone back 6 months, 12 months, 18 months later to look at whether the work we've done with technology has really had an impact and benefited the personnel that we worked with. Yeah, I'm gonna... So really, in summary, as it says here, one size does not fit all. I think it's key to point out that different technologies in different spaces for different groups of people on that spectrum will be different, and that's worth recognizing. Using technologies to augment or enable skills is something that I think has been done successfully, can be done more successfully. A variety of different technologies have been used, and I think as you pointed out, there is a real need as we step through into these new areas of technology, we look at the potential for ethics and how that can be addressed appropriately. There's a real problem with the sort of here today, gone tomorrow. So we go in with research, as researchers very excited about a new piece of technology. We go in, it's there today, and then we take it away and it's gone, or maybe the technology doesn't exist anymore. So there's a real issue around how the technology can be embedded and stay embedded. We need to engage with the populations that we're working with, and in the UK, currently you would, and in the US actually, you wouldn't be able to get funding to work with autistic groups unless you were involving them in the research now, having them as co-researchers, having them as co-designers of that work. And I think there's a real issue around scaling projects up with all the projects I've looked at and even the projects I've been involved with. So how does it, we might have impacted small groups, how do we scale that up? Are other challenges for the area. So I hope that's on time and so on. But really just to thank you all very much for coming to listen to some of the work I've been involved with and the sort of state of the art in the field. Thank you very much, Hilva, for inviting me along. I really appreciated the chance to come and speak with you. And despite the usually cold weather here, thank you all very much for the warm welcome. Everyone I've come into contact with had a warm welcome, so thank you.